5 myths about the Romans. Myth number 1. Most gladiator fights were not to the death. One of the most enduring images of ancient Rome is that of a defeated gladiator awaiting his fate, a crowd watching with bated breath to see whether the emperor would decide to be merciful and spare his life with a thumbs up, or condemn him to death with a thumbs down. Whilst being a gladiator in ancient Rome was certainly a risky business, with the threat of death or severe injury ever present, it was not quite as dangerous as we often believe. Gladiators were seen as an expensive commodity. They were highly trained fighters who were leased out to provide entertainment. And if they were killed in action, those organizing the games would be forced to pay substantial fees, up to 50 times that of the rental cost. Actual matches to the death were a relatively rare occurrence and may have even required imperial authorization. Gladiatorial training was focused more on how to subdue an opponent than to how to land a killing blow. And there is evidence suggesting that they valued the idea of mercy toward their competitors. Several epitaphs dedicated to men who fell in the arena proudly proclaim that they saved many souls or hurt no one. We also know the career records for several gladiators, such as Flamma, whose tomb tells us that he fought 34 times with 21 wins, 9 draws, and 4 losses. Finally, the popular idea that thumbs up meant life and thumbs down death is almost certainly wrong. Roman sources are unclear on the precise gestures used and describe the thumb as being in a variety of positions. However, the most likely interpretation of the evidence suggests that thumbs up actually meant death, while a closed fist was a sign for mercy. Myth number 2. Nero did not fiddle whilst Rome burnt. The Emperor Nero has gone down as one of history's greatest monsters. To list just a few of the crimes he allegedly committed, he had his mother murdered, his first wife executed, kicked the second one to death while she was pregnant with his child, and ordered the persecution of Christians. Perhaps the most famous accusation leveled against him, though, is that he fiddled whilst Rome burnt. The incident to which this refers is the Great Fire of Rome, a terrible conflagration that began in mid-July of 64 AD and raged almost continuously for 9 days. By the time the flames finally died down, approximately 70% of Rome lay in ruins. There are a few problems with the story, though, not the least of which is that the fiddle would not be invented for another 1,500 years. The historian Tacitus, who provided us with one of the best accounts of the fire, claims that on the evening it broke out, Nero was 35 miles outside of Rome, at his villa in Antium, and that he returned to Rome when the flames threatened his own house. In an attempt to help the city's desperate population, Nero opened up the public buildings, and even his own gardens, as shelters, and ensured the price of grain was kept artificially low. The closest that Tacitus comes to the fiddling myth is to tell of a report that supposedly circulated in the immediate aftermath of the fire, stating that Nero took to his private stage and sang the destruction of Troy. Myth number 3. Roman statues were not pure white. The classical world was much more colorful than we've been led to believe. In museums around the world, the classical galleries are filled with row upon row of pristine white sculptures. For centuries, the accepted truth about Roman and Greek sculpture has been that it was always left undecorated. From the Renaissance onwards, European art has been dominated by this belief in a pure classical aesthetic, that brilliant white marble and the occasional bronze represented the zenith of artistic output of the ancient world. The Greeks, and later the Romans, it was argued, understood that true beauty was found in simplicity and had no need for color in their creations. Unfortunately for the proponents of this view, there is now overwhelming evidence that they were completely wrong. Fragmentary remains of pigmentation, as well as secondary evidence such as a vase that depicts an artist painting a statue, provide irrefutable evidence that not only were ancient sculptures colorful, but if anything, they could be considered a little gaudy to modern eyes. Color faded from the ancient Western world in multiple ways, sometimes through the gradual erosion that came from being buried underground for several centuries, sometimes from exposure to the elements upon excavation, and other times from the efforts of overzealous archaeologists and curators who believed in preserving the idea of a pure white ancient aesthetic and scrubbed all trace of pigmentation from their finds. Myth number 4. Romans didn't always wear togas. Most people, when asked to picture an ancient Roman, will conjure up an image of a toga-clad individual. This is understandable. The use of togas is ubiquitous throughout Roman art, It was supposedly the clothing of choice of the mythological founder, Romulus. The Roman poet Virgil even described the Romans as the gens togata, or the race that wears the toga. However, it's important to remember that through their art, the Romans were presenting an idealized image of themselves. Togas were expensive, heavy, and longer ones required the help of another person to put on. In other words, they were not very practical for everyday wear, especially for those doing manual labor. During the Republic, it's believed that both men and women were able to wear togas. However, as time went on, women came to favor wearing the stola, a type of pleated dress, and the toga came to be viewed as the traditional formal wear of adult males. In fact, a woman found to be an adulteress could be forced to wear a toga to highlight that she no longer demonstrated the virtues necessary to be considered a moral Roman woman. The simple tunic would have been the most common item of clothing for both genders, and wearing the toga was rare enough that the Roman satirist Juvenal was prompted to write, "There are many parts of Italy, to tell the truth, in which no man puts on the toga until he is dead." Myth number 5. The empire was not solely brought down by barbarian raids. This one may be partially true. There were increasing barbarian raids across much of the empire throughout the 4th and 5th centuries, with Rome itself being sacked on 3 occasions. However, this was not the sole reason for the collapse of the empire. Internal political instability, economic crises, cultural changes, and plagues were all major contributing factors. Between 193 AD and 293 AD, in a period that is now referred to as the Crisis of the 3rd Century, there were more than 70 emperors, many of whom were installed by and assassinated by the military. By contrast, in the 178 years prior to the crisis, there had only been 14. The constant changeover in power created huge amounts of instability across the Roman world and saw fragmentation of the empire into several smaller autonomous units. Theodosius was the last emperor to rule over a united Roman Empire. In 395 AD, he divided the empire into eastern and western portions. This proved to be beneficial for the lands that made up the Eastern Empire, but didn't prevent the deterioration of the Western Roman Empire. By the early 5th century, Rome had diminished to the extent that it was no longer considered the administrative capital. The western half of the empire finally collapsed in 476 AD, when its last emperor, Romulus Augustulus, was deposed by the barbarian Odoacer. The Eastern Roman Empire, however, continued to flourish for the next 1,000 years, becoming what we more commonly refer to as the Byzantine Empire, and didn't come to an end until its capital, Constantinople, was conquered by the Ottoman Empire in 1453 AD.